Hi students, continuing chapter 1, what is psychology? We have two topics for today. First is branches of psychology, and the second topic related to that is psychologist at work. Let's start with first topic. Now, when we talk about branches of psychology, which is basically talking about the scope of psychology in various fields. So, where do we apply psychology? See, one is the basic psychology, which is the theoretical principles, theories, principles of psychology. The other is applying the same principles in different areas. So, when we talk about application, we have psychology which is used everywhere, be it in daily life, be it in special professions. It is used everywhere. So, every area, every discipline, every field uses psychology and its principles. Now, as far as your textbook is concerned, you have this topic, branches of psychology, but at the same time in the syllabus it is edited. But for you to understand where is psychology applied so that you can take it up as a further career after 2 years of study, this is where the scope lies. So let's start with the branches. We have the first branch, which is cognitive psychology. It is linked to a computer. So it is more like an information processing system where information is coming in, which is encoded, the input is given, it is processed in the mind, in the brain, and the same information after being processed is given outside as a receptive mechanism. That is input, processing and output like a computer. This is where cognitive psychology stays very close to the mind information processing system, the computer system. Let's look at it. It investigates mental processes involved in acquisition, storage, manipulation and transformation of information received from the environment. Now, don't get confused with the heavy words here. Acquisition basically is the input, the acquiring of the information, keeping it as a storage, as a refrigerator, you keep the storage, and then processing it, that is manipulation, and after processing it is transformed and output is given. That is what is cognitive psychology. A lot of other disciplines are also collaborated with it, for example, neuroscientists, as we had seen in the last class, and also computer scientists. These are the people basically collaborating with the cognitive scientist. Let's move on to the second branch, which is biological psychology. Now, as the name suggests, a lot of students ask this question that why are we studying biology in psychology? What is the role of studying the human brain, the human mind, the human endocrine system, the hormonal system, the genetics? Why are we studying all this? What is the use of it? It's a very relevant question. And we are studying, obviously, if we do not understand about our physiology, our body, how will we apply it in psychology? So, for us to apply it, we need to first know our physical reactions. Only then we can transform them into our psychological reactions. So, that is where biological psychology comes into picture. It focuses on the relationship between behavior and the physical system. Now, this also talks about similar field, which is neuropsychology. Now, a lot of you would have seen in the movie Munna Bhai MBBS that a term was used named chemical locha. Now, this term seems a very funny term, but when we translate into biological psychology or neuropsychology, it is actually known as neurotransmitters. These are chemical substances in the brain which help you in dealing with different processes, like a lot of problems, a lot of malfunction, a lot of abnormality comes into picture, a lot of mental illness comes into picture if these are not balanced and normal. And that is a result of our thinking or our genes. That is neuropsychology. It studies the role of neurotransmitters and their association with the mental functions. One more concept associated here is when we do any kind of physical scan, the scan of the brain like EEG, or we do a scan like MRI, all these scans also tell you about the functioning or the basic processes of the brain. That is what neuropsychologists deal with, and they collaborate with neuroscientists again, they collaborate with neurologists, that is what they do, they collaborate with zoologists also. Let's move on to the next branch, which is developmental psychology. Now, as the name suggests, development basically deals with the age-wise transition across the different processes. So, intelligence develops at a particular age, starts developing at a particular age, a variable of psychology is intelligence, and then it moves on. So, first 5 years of a child's life, intelligence starts developing, and thereafter it keeps on progressing till 15 years. So this is development. We talk about adolescence. So we start from infancy, in fact, prenatal stage also, before a fetus is born, before an infant actually comes into this world. Before that also the process starts. That's development. Across ages, your development in different psychological processes. So memory develops, intelligence develops, creativity develops, problem solving develops across ages. So infancy, childhood, adolescent, a lot of you will be in the same age, adolescence, and then young adults, and then middle age and old age. So all these ages are studied. We especially focus on adolescents, and we especially focus on elderly people because they also have a lot of needs that need to be catered to. That is developmental psychology. It studies the physical, social, and psychological changes that occur at different stages of life. We move on to the next one, which is social psychology. Now, social psychology deals with society like we had seen earlier. Sociology and social psychology are quite similar. A lot of psychological processes here are handled. For instance, aggression, attachment, interpersonal relations, intergroup relations, motivation in a societal setup, all such helping behaviors. A lot of such behaviors are handled in social psychology. It explores how people are affected by their social environments, how people think and influence others. That is social psychology. So social attitudes are studied, the attitude with relation to culture and society, that is what is studied in social psychology. We move on to the next, which is cross-cultural and cultural psychology. Every culture has its unique feature. India has a unique feature of bonding with the relatives. US has a unique feature of individuality, their own success. Japan has another feature of hardworking people. So every culture has a different perspective. That is what we need to understand, that an individual born in a particular culture, how will he be groomed? How will his personality be? How will his socialization be? All of it comes in the cultural and cross-cultural psychology. And this is a very beautiful branch because when you go out to different cultures, to explore different cultures, you definitely get an idea as to how to interact with these cultures, what is acceptable, what is not acceptable. That is cross-cultural or cultural psychology. It examines the role of culture in understanding behavior, thought, and emotions. Next one is environmental psychology. Now, environmental psychology deals with, you might be thinking, what is the connection of environment and psychology? Why are the two connected? They are very much connected. Think of an instance of road rage in summers. In summers, when you have an instance where hitting another car would definitely result in a lot of aggression, it even leads to murders. To that extent, the aggression comes out. So this is where we understand the role of environmental psychology, where the physical setting, if it's too hot, if it's not comfortable physical setting, or if it's not a comfortable environment, will you be able to study? So that is the physical setting, the heat, the temperature, the surroundings around, the climate around, all of that affects. Now look at the definition. It studies the interaction of physical factors such as temperature, humidity, etc. on human behavior. Impact of tsunami, impact of any natural calamity on human behavior, what happens to them, the mental illness that happens to them after that, how are they handled, the counseling that is done, the rehabilitation that is done, all of it comes in environmental psychology. Okay, health psychology is next. Now again, a very interesting question, what is the connection of health and psychology? How can health and psychology be connected? So here we can understand the fact that when you go to a certain doctor who gives you, let's say you sit with the doctor for 1 hour, you go to another doctor who just checks you out quickly, asks you a few symptoms and just writes your prescription and you move out. Which doctor will you prefer going to? Obviously the first one, because you were more satisfied that he heard you out, he was more receptive, he understood what the problem you were facing and he handled you accordingly. So the time, the care given by the doctor is something that you would prefer. And therefore, health psychologists come into picture. We also talk about certain special cases here. Somebody's suffering from a terminal illness like AIDS, like HIV. They are facing problem. Now, they again need counseling. They also need somebody who can support them, somebody who can understand them, their needs, what they are going through, what they are facing. That is where health psychologists come into picture. And also when we talk about the definition, it focuses on the role of psychological factors in the development, prevention, and treatment of certain illnesses. Now just imagine going to a dentist is so anxiety provoking. You're so stressed out before you go to a dentist because the whole setup seems so scary. And this is where psychologists come into picture. Every hospital is supposed to have a psychologist who can cater to the anxiety, the stress, the tension that the patients are facing and handle them accordingly. So starting with the treatment, the diagnosis, any kind of problem that the person is facing, illness that the person is facing, could be a physical illness, could be a mental illness. For the mental illness, especially, psychologists are deputed by the hospitals or the clinics. So any kind of issues related to the mind, the psychologist definitely comes into picture and helps out. That is what is health psychology. Then we move on to educational psychology. Now again, education and psychology both have a very good connection, because any kind of instructional methods, the way your teacher teaches you in class, any kind of research that is required in the way education is framed, that is where education psychology comes into picture. So this can tell you the instance that, you know, psychology is used everywhere, is used, you know, it is there in every field. You can use, become a psychologist in any area that you prefer, and you can get trained in that specially. We move on to the next. It is sports psychology. Now this is also very interesting. Sports and psychology. A lot of sports psychologists are associated with the cricket teams. What is their role out there? Why are they there? The basic role is to motivate players to give their best performance. That will happen when they reduce their anxiety level, the arousal level, the stress level. That will happen when they are very motivated. So reducing stress, motivating the players so that they can perform at the best possible level is the role of the sports psychologist. We also have a lot of emerging branches of psychology. Look at it. Aviation psychology, space psychology, military psychology, forensic psychology, rural psychology, engineering psychology, managerial psychology, women's psychology, political psychology, and criminal psychology. Look at it, the way it is so fascinating that you have psychology in so many fields. When we combine it, aviation and space basically talk about psychologist's role for astronauts, for space, dealing with the space issues. Then we have military, a very famous branch of psychology. A lot of military psychologists are there. There are separate courses for military psychology where people take up psychological principles, apply them to the military setting, the army setting, dealing with the army and military so that they are very effective. That is again the role of the psychologists out there. Then we have forensic psychology, a very good area. There are a lot of courses for forensic psychologists. A lot of children take up this stream, MSc, BSc, forensic psychology in colleges. This area, when you talk about it, is again very interesting because it talks about how a particular criminal can be handled, how the particular data that you get from the site of the crime, all of that helps you deal with forensic. We also have rural, engineering, managerial, women's psychology. This is self-explanatory. Let's quickly wind up this aspect of psychologist at work. We have clinical psychologists who are dealing with the clinical setup. Clinical setup in the sense that when you talk about a very serious mental illness, identification of that, treatment of that in the clinical setup, any kind of mental illness, they are basically studying theoretical principles and applying it, skills which are applied in therapy. That is what they do in the clinics. Counseling psychologists, they basically cater to less serious day-to-day problems, and they cater to emotional and motivational problems of children and of other areas like marriage counseling, like career counseling and all of that. Community psychologists deal with the rural setting. They deal with the community in general, rehabilitation of that, special needs of people. School psychologists deal with the school programs. They deal with the school setup, the management and the children and the parents, instructions given, special needs of children, all of that. Organizational is the last area. They basically deal with a particular MNC, let's say a particular multinational organization, where a psychologist takes in people through psychological testing, selects people which are best suited for the particular job profile, trains them also in areas like stress management, counsels them also, leadership management, performance, the best performance, all of that. And along with that, psychologists are involved in dealing with any issues that the employees are facing, any work condition problems and all of that. That is organizational psychology. So today we covered psychologists at work and branches, which included close to 25 branches. Every branch is important, but a lot of branches which we covered in psychologists at work, that's the most important, because that has the practical application that you can pursue after your course is completed. Thank you.